It's not by chance that the water of the ocean contains the same chemical elements as the blood in our veins. The first living being was a bacteria that appeared in the sea almost 4,000 million years ago. And all life on Earth evolved from it, including us. Maybe this is why we always feel something special when we look at the sea. Like we feel at home.
Philippines is located in Southeast Asia. It's an archipelago with 7,107 islands, and most of these islands are surrounded with coral reef. That's why many people are coming here, because we are famous for scuba diving. The life in the Philippines is very slow. People here have more time to relax and enjoy themselves, enjoy their life. That's why the Filipino people are known to be a very friendly people. Before I opened up a dive shop, I was a fisherman because my father was a fisherman. And then I find the interest in scuba diving. That's why I opened up a small dive shop. I like the ocean, and I'd like to watch the beautiful corals underwater. That's why I dive.
The Philippines is located within the coral triangle, and it's a really, really important aspect for conservation and research because we have such a beautiful, diverse community of coral here that it's a perfect example to study, but it's also really, really important for the people because of such beautiful reefs. They have an abundance of fish, so it's really important for their livelihoods, but it also brings in the fish for tourism, for their food. That's important both ecologically and economically because you've got fish species that are coastal but also pelagic coming in, breeding, having a safe ground, and then they in turn are providing fish stocks for countless people here. Coral is actually an animal. There's been so much change of it was a rock, then it was a plant, but now it's everyone is in agreement it is an animal, but it lives in a symbiotic relationship with algae, so they work together. With that relationship, they're able to take sunlight and they convert that into energy, and using that energy, they are building the big, beautiful structures that we see. The variety is really stunning. Massive corals that can look like big living boulders. Another ones that look like big branches. Or they look like beautiful plates. Gorgonians, which they look like fans, and they live out in deeper waters. We haven't been able to count exactly how many species we've got, but they're just mind-blowingly beautiful.
Scuba diving introduces you into the underwater world. a world completely different from what we know and see on land. The world of the strangest creatures and surrealistic landscapes with vertical walls that fall into the abyss or gentle slopes that host the secrets of history in sunken wrecks. A weightless world in which you are free to move in any direction of space. A world to explore.
Scuba diving, if you respect the rules, is not dangerous. You breathe air. You breathe the same air than here, exactly the same air. It's 21% oxygen, but basically 79% nitrogen. But there is changement in the water. There is the phenomenon of pressure and about the volume of air that they get compressed when you're going down. Inside your body, what happens? You breathe more air. The oxygen is not a problem with recreational diving. It's the nitrogen. At the surface now, the nitrogen doesn't affect your body, it goes nowhere. But when you provide more nitrogen, the nitrogen goes somewhere in your body and stay, okay? And it takes time to eliminate the nitrogen. You have just time to follow underwater. Deeper you go, less time you stay. We call it the no decompression limit. For example, it's 56 minutes at 18 meters or 20 minutes at 30 meters. It's exactly the same amount of nitrogen, but deeper you go, more you breathe, so faster you get saturated of nitrogen. If you don't go over the limit, you go up slowly and you do just a safety stop, nothing can happen.
So when we go diving, we cannot talk, obviously. To communicate with the other divers, we use hand signals. This means how much air do you have in your tank? Low on air. This means strong current. Okay sign. Turtle. This is octopus. This one's octopus. Whale shark. Whale sharks, this one. The name sounds like it's whale shark. Wow, it's the biggest shark. But don't be afraid. They're very gentle creatures. They're very curious animals. They will go near the divers or will try to sometimes go above because when the divers exhale, they release the bubbles. And they like the feeling of the bubbles going underneath their body. They usually eat small stuff, okay, like plankton, krill. Small shrimp, they don't have the big teeth.
One of the things that I fall in love about being underwater are the little things that we call nudibranchs. They are the sea slugs of the water. They are the snails that doesn't have the shells. And they crawl onto the ground or the bottom of the sea and finding things that they eat. Nudibranchs are what they eat. So they eat the things that are poisonous and that makes them quite poisonous as well. And their colors resembles that you shouldn't be touching them. I've seen a nudibranch that is so as thin as your hair. There's a lot of different macros when you look at it. What you need is just the patience to find them. Sometimes you will be surprised of the things that is underwater that doesn't, you think that they don't belong, but they actually exist. And that's an amazing part for me to see those little things. Sometimes people just find it that they would love to do diving. Some people are scared of the water. What you can only do is just to give it a bit of a try and see it for yourself. Thank you.
night dive usually occurs when the sun sets, from let's say 6 p.m. to 4 a.m. So this is called a night dive because it's dark all over and your only view is your light. So your focus will be one area at a time. Also, you can turn up your light underwater and then see planktons glowing when you disturb the water. This is very interesting because you'll see critters that you don't usually see in the morning. Generally, most fish live in a reef because they can be protected from predators. So this is symbiosis. You can observe this with this anemone fish. The famous one is called Nemo in the movie. They take shelter on these anemones. The fish is protected from their predators. The anemones being cleaned by this fish. So that's why it's called symbiosis, because they both benefit from the relationship. The corals can benefit from the turtle as well because they are the one responsible eating the dead corals. So it's a natural process of killing the weak and then regenerating new corals.
Another animal who likes to eat the coral is the parrotfish.
The parrotfish, you think that they're destroying the corals, but they're not. They're actually helping the corals to grow. When parrotfish eat the corals, they shit out the sand.
The reef, it's like a busy city, where its inhabitants have their own routine.
The fish, sometimes they have parasites, and then they go to these cleaning stations. The fish just try to go there, and then they try to clean the gills. There might be small parasites, and also in their body. In the reef, there's many different kinds of fish, many different colors. Any color you can think of, there's underneath the ocean. If you see sharks on a reef, that is a good sign that the reef is healthy, because sharks is one of the apex predators. So some other fish won't be overpopulated, okay? So it helps them regulate the fish population on a certain area of reef. Sometimes you only see them on TV, but once you see them up close, personal, it's a different story.
Sharks are majestic creatures. And we shouldn't be afraid of being with them because we are not their food. They appeared in the ocean before the dinosaurs, 400 million years ago. And just in the last 50 years, 90% of the population disappeared because of us.
The most venomous animals are found in the ocean or the reef. This is all one weaponry that they employ to protect themselves from being eaten from other animals. And this is also the quicker way to get food, like for example, a sea snake or a sea crayed. The venom of the sea crayed is 10 times more potent than the cobra. Lionfish, they're beautiful to see, but their spines are tacked with venoms. Stonefish, scorpionfish. I have observed through my years of diving that the venomous fish are not aggressive towards other animals, but they have this venom to protect themselves. If you know the workings of these animals, you will be fascinated by their beauty. But if you don't know and you just go and touch or take anything, it's a dangerous place for you. I teach my students on how to protect themselves first and how to protect the reef next. So if you protect yourself, the same time you're protecting the reef. Because if you're a responsible diver, you don't put your fins down on any reef, or you don't sit on those corals or take photo sitting or inclining, or you know. In diving, sometimes money comes in the way and people just leave you be, just take your money and sign you off as a diver. For me personally, it's an advocate. For me, I advocate for good diving practices, because me, when I was introduced to diving, I was in love, and my mind was open about how important it is for us to protect the marine life.
Japanese na tutulong ang Amerika, kaya sila nagatago na sa mga isla-isla. Ang iba, dinalagyan ng yung. Sabi ko nga sa tatay ko, maraming ibon. Sabi ng tatay ko, hindi ibon niyan, eroplano. Sa balita ko, hanggang 30 meters sa ilalim, naaabot na ngayon.
My first goal was to work on the shipwreck. And the first dive site was Kogio, I remember well. And I didn't expect anything, just to see a shipwreck and to go inside. When I started the descent, visibility was not that good. So it was a mystery. I didn't know what I have to expect it. And when he asked me, "Are you okay? We're gonna go inside." I say, "Of course, I'm okay, we go inside." And when I went inside, I felt my pulse. More and more and more. Between wreck diving and reef diving, some divers should have abilities or more knowledge, okay? Because it's not the same. It can be narrow, so most important is the buoyancy, because some parts are sharp and they can injure themselves. If the shipwreck is big, it's dark inside, you can just consider it like a night dive. It's dark, you have a flashlight and different end signal or flashlight signal. You have to teach them how to be in the darkness.
Once we go down here, we just touch down first, almost in a water. Tsushima is a seaplane tender before from the Japanese. It's a warship, and you can see the machine gun. The Olympia Maru, or the former name is the Tangat Wreck. So yeah, it's a cargo ship as well. It's big. You can touch down there like 28 to 30 meters. So you can see the oil, mini oil barrel, cement bags, yeah, and the prison area or the jail room. You can see the sunlight, the holes from the bomb, and just thinking that there's so many people died on that inside. So I never had a happen about my diver since I guide, but last year there's a Japanese diver died on that wreck. There's a tendency that your diver will be lost, especially if there's some intersection. He didn't follow the guide, that's why he go to the another way. So he got out of air. You just always follow with the guide.
The water life, the marine life, it's just incredible because all the fishes and all the marine life that you see on the shipwrecks never quit the shipwreck. They got sunk here, for example, in Coron since 74 years ago. Okay? So when you see a big flowers of coral, you can say that, so this size, 70 years old, it's full of marine life. It's an artificial reef, an incredible artificial reef. Okay, there is a lot of corals on it. Without the corals, I think, yeah, the shipwrecks would be destroyed by the currents and everything. But the coral reef just make the structure of the wreck stronger.
I love diving a lot. You get to learn a lot about the fish, the coral reefs, and you can see if the coral reef is actually healthy.
It's the good time to start scuba diving because maybe in a few years we will not have coral reef or we will not have spaces that we can cross in the water that your child will never see.
The more I have been diving, the more I feel like I want to learn about what is underwater so that we can also protect it for the future, that other divers can also come and enjoy the same experience that we have.
Unfortunately, something we'll find for sure in every ocean on the planet is plastic. No matter whether we throw it up on the highest mountain or into the busiest city, all our waste will eventually end up in the sea, polluting, poisoning, and killing its inhabitants.
The more plastic that's getting dumped into the ocean, it is affecting animals. They are starting to ingest it once the plastic has broken down into microplastics. It becomes toxic, and then it's going to affect all the other animals into a massive buildup.
Climate change threatens all life on Earth, especially the coral reef. The rise in temperature as a result of our emissions into the atmosphere caused the algae living inside the coral to abandon it. Without the algae, the coral becomes white, losing the ability to photosynthesize. They starve, become weaker, and easily die. This is called bleaching, and it is spreading all around the world. The green turtles of the Pacific reefs are facing extinction because of global warming. The gender of the turtle is determined by the temperature of the nest. When eggs are warmer, more females are born. Nowadays, 99% of the population is female, making procreation difficult to continue the species.
I Another threat also that is actually starting to come more to light now, ocean acidification. So this is another byproduct of climate change. Burning of fossil fuels, we are putting more carbon dioxide out into the atmosphere, and the ocean is actually the largest carbon sink. It takes away that carbon out of the atmosphere, and it's now affecting the corals because the water is becoming too acidic. The coral skeletons become weak, so it's easier for them to break, and it's also easier for them to catch diseases. If you are on a coral reef, a few things that you can do, be wary of what sun cream you use. It's very important to try to look for reef-safe sun cream because the chemicals in most brands is really toxic to corals. If you do go diving or snorkeling, please don't touch the corals.
Also, the biggest threat is dynamite fishing, which is very destructive, both marine life and humans as well, because they get blown, their hands are get blown by the dynamite. And the coral reef, when they get blown, it takes long time for them to recover. They cannot recover overnight. Usually, we just want to leave for the day. We just want to catch fish now and then never think of a long-term solution. So with the advent of the marine protected areas, people are starting to realize that this is much more beneficial because fishes and reef can thrive, fishes can grow in numbers, and then when this fish comes out of the marine protected area, we can fish them out and we benefit from it.
Coral Cay was established in 1986 and has gone on to work in many, many projects around the world. For example, here in the Philippines, we work for the provincial government of Southern Leyte. So we help with them. We help to advise areas which we think would be good for implementing MPAs. We also run a scholar program. So once a month, we take one local individual, we teach them to dive, and we teach them about the science that we do here.
Scuba diving has become a tool to create awareness about the environmental problems of the sea. Watching for yourself the beauty, complexity, and fragility of marine life arouses a need to protect this amazing creation of nature for its continuance on Earth.